So today I'm presenting all, I mean, I have prepared the slides for all the three chapters, but let's see how much we can accomplish. I'm starting with the very first question from Model Basics chapter. In this question, we are given a simulated data set. And from that, we are asked to decide what is the influence of the outliers on the model performance. One downside of linear model is that it is sensitive to unusual values because the distance incorporates a squared term. We can fit a linear model to the simulated data and visualize the result, rerun it for a few times to generate a different simulated data set. What do you notice about the model? And this simulated data set includes the function RT, that is the T distribution, a random number generated from T distribution. And this is one of the culprits in the performance of this model. We can see it using the ggplot visualization. See, there are a few outliers like here. If you can see the cursor at this place, yes. These are the two outliers, and even the upper right corner also there are a few. And because they are at a quite far distance, the slope has changed to this. If this were not the case, this outlier were not present in the model, I am sure that the slope would have been different. In this kind of data set, in the present form, we cannot run this simulation multiple times. So we will have to generate a custom function, a user-defined function, so that we can rerun this multiple times. And we are adding one more column, dot ID, so that we can run it multiple times, and ID equal to I, we repeat it 12 times here. And then using facet ref, we are visualizing all these 12 times. So we can see that there are a few outliers each time. The outliers are the one which are far away from the red line. Red line is the regression line here. We have used the smooth equal to LM so that it represents the regression line. This is happening, these outliers are happening because we are using RT function. It uses the T distribution, which gives more weighted to outlier compared to normal distribution. Just to visualize this, we are comparing the two lines, two curves from normal distribution and T distribution. See, this blue line is from T distribution, which gives here more weighted on both the side, right and left sides. There are very few outliers in the red line, which is, belongs to normal distribution. But for T distribution, there are more outliers. So we can conclude that in this kind of distribution, there will be more weightage given to outliers. And therefore, the regression line will also change. The intercept and slope both will change here. The next exercise asks, one way to make linear model more robust is to use different distance measure. For example, instead of root mean square distance, we can use mean absolute distance. For mean absolute difference, there is no function. We will have to generate it our own. We are defining a function which has two input variables, model and data. And then we calculate this difference as mean absolute difference. And make prediction function is also required here, which we have used earlier. Then we'll have to check the parameters of this using this optim function. I have used this custom code. Best for linear regression and most best for this mean absolute difference. So we can see here that both the numbers change. I am not sure what the interpretation of this would be, but still, it differs a lot. Both the slope and the intercept, both are changing here. Do you have any other interpretation in this case for these two numbers?
No, I am no. Actually, I'm also side by side looking at the exercise. I'm not finding anything new, but you have covered it. So I don't know what to interpret.
Okay. In fact, in some of the exercises, even the solution code was not working in my laptop. So I had to ask in Slack how I can go ahead.
Okay.
In the next exercise, one challenge is performing numerical optimization is that it is only guaranteed to find a local optimum. What is the problem with optimizing a three-parameter model like this? I have not, in the solution, there is some code also, but it is quite long and lengthy. But because we are doing optimization, it seems that the model will find optimum using the iteration procedure only. And for iteration, we will have to take a starting point. And if the starting point differs, the solution will also differ. And that's why it will be a local optimum only. It will not be global optimum, because probably the global optimum doesn't exist. In the next question, instead of using LM to filter straight line, we can use lowest function also. If repeat the process of model fitting, grid generation, prediction, and visualization on SIM1, the inbuilt dataset, using the lowest function instead of LM. How do we compare it with GeomSmooth? The straightforward answer is that GeomSmooth by default uses lowest function only. So if you use only GeomSmooth bracket, then it will give you lowest function only. If you want to use LM, then you will have to specify that method is equal to LM. So for this code, I have fitted both SIM1 lowest. Instead of using LM function, I am using lowest function. And SIM1 LM, the usual LM function. And then we are generating grid, adding prediction also. We are adding residual from both LM and lowest. And then we are plotting both side by side.
This was tidy models, no? Add predictions, add residuals.
No, add model, add prediction and add residuals come from model error function, model error package, not from tidy model.
Okay.
And tidy models have different procedure also. So I'm not even discussing it.
Like
a recipe. Yes, you will have to create first LM specification. And then there will be another step called fit. First, you create a preprocessor or say some recipe and parsnip recipe, and thereafter you will fit it. So I am not covering it right now.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, my bad. Continue.
It's okay. So I am visualizing this lowest line here. And we can see that this lowest line is not a straight line because it is locally optimized regression kind of thing. Locally weighted. It's not a global weighted, which would be a straight line in LM function. So in the next curve, in the next job, I am adding reference line at zero. Geom ref line also comes from a modular function only. So we can visualize how the residuals are behaving from both the side of the reference line of zero. And we can see that there is no fixed pattern as such. So lowest function also behaves just like your LM in this particular case. But the last question in this, how does geom smooth compare to lowest? So the answer is here that geom smooth function by default uses lowest formula. So if you want to change, you will have to specify like, yes, formula equal to LM. If you don't specify this formula equal to anything, then it will by default use lowest only. So it will be the same. Even if you don't use here lowest, it will be automatically this line only. The next question, add prediction is paired with gather prediction and spread prediction. There are these three functions from modular package. So how do this differ? The difference is that add prediction can add prediction only from one model at a time. If you have constructed multiple models, you cannot do it in one step using add prediction. If you want to do that kind of thing, then you will have to use gather prediction or spread prediction. If you have say model one, model two, model three, in that case, if you use add prediction, you can add only prediction from model one at a time. Then you, in the next step, you will have to use add prediction model two, then add prediction model three. But if you are using gather prediction, then it will add the prediction at the same time, gather prediction into bracket model one, model two, model three. So only in one step you can add the prediction from all the three models. Then next, what does geom ref line do? From where it comes and why is it displaying reference line in plot showing residual? Is it useful and important? Yes. It is also coming from modular package only. It will add a reference line at zero, like we have seen here in the above graph. It is helping us to visualize the residual of a model. We can check, is there any symmetrical pattern above zero and below zero, or is there anything else? For example, if there would be a curved line, then also it would be useful to visualize it. But here we cannot see that kind of pattern also. The next question asks, why would you want to look at a frequency polygon of absolute residuals? And what are the pros and cons compared to looking at the raw residuals? I have never used a frequency polygon like that, but still, the frequency polygon shows the absolute value of the residual. This is helpful in understanding the spread of the residual. Because it is absolute value, I think some information is definitely lost. However, the linear regression model has assumption that the residuals have mean zero. So if you use absolute numbers of the residual, then we cannot determine whether the mean is zero in this case or not. Because we can't see the sign of residual, we cannot determine whether this assumption is true or not for this particular model. So in this case, we would probably visualize the residual versus fitted plot. And for this kind of plot, I think the Bayes-R function plot is much better compared to ggplot. Because it has simple argument, just plot into bracket model name. Then it will give you four graphs at the same time. If you want to do this kind of functionality using ggplot, I think you will have to check many more packages. For example, there is one Lindia package, L-I-N-D-I-A. Lindia stands for linear diagnosis. So this package gives you all the six diagnostic plot at the same time. just one command and you will have the access to all these things. The next question asks, what happens if you repeat the analysis of SIM2 using a model without intercept? What will happen to the model equation and what will happen to the prediction? So in that case, we will have to change the formula. Generally, when we use the formula, we use LM into bracket Y tilde X. If you write it that way, the intercept will be incorporated in the function. But if you want to exclude the intercept, then you will have to specify it using minus one. The minus one term removes the intercept. The minus one term specifies that there is no intercept in this model. So I'm giving it a name mode two not intercept. And mode two with intercept will be the regular LM Y tilde X, same data, but the different models. And then I am using the base R function cbind. So that all the columns are broom tidy. So no intercept and with intercept, both the models are combined here. And if we see, the predicted value will remain same. Only see the estimate 1.15 when it comes to no intercept, and another estimate with model is the same. So there won't be much difference. The prediction will be the same. Then from in the next exercise, we can use model matrix function to explore the equation generated in the model fit on the simulated data set SIM3 and SIM4. Why is this asterisk a good shorthand for interaction? We can experiment here using model matrix directly. We are giving a LM formula and use it on model matrix, use it as an input to model matrix function. Y tilde X1 interact with X2. So it will give you all the model matrix. X1 remains the same, but X2 has four levels A, B, C, and D. But here we can see that A level is excluded. It only shows us X2B, X2C, and X2D, but A level is completely excluded. Why? Because if we include it, there will be a problem of multicollinearity. In econometrics, we call it dummy variable trap. See, in this case, what happens? X1 B is 0, that means X1 is not B. X2 C is 0, that means it is not C. And X2 D is 0, that means it is not D also. That means X2 is A in this case. You can see in the first three rows, X2 B, X2 C, and X2 D all are 0. That means these three belong to A level in X2 variable. So what happens is the sum of this four variables. I am assuming that X2A is also included in this model. Suppose there is one more column X2A, then what would happen? The sum of this four column X2A, X2B, X2C, and X2D, it will always be equal to one. But X1 is one all the time. Probably if we see sometime it will not be one. But at least the intercept will intercept column will always be one, right? So in this case, what happens? The intercept value and the sum of X1A, X2B, X2C, and X2D, these four columns, this will always be the same. And therefore, this matrix cannot be solved. In other words, if we add x to a column as well, then we cannot find the solution of this formula, this function. Because it is in matrix algebra, this matrix cannot be transposed, we cannot find that x transpose x inverse x transpose b, that is the LM formula in matrix notation. And therefore we are excluding one level. And when we use it asterisk, it gives everything. That means it will include x1 also and all the level of x2 and the multiplication of all these. And that's why we are saying that asterisk is a good shorthand for interaction. In econometrics, we call it main effect and the interaction effect, both are included. We can see x2 is a categorical, I'm just summarizing it in narrative here. We can confirm this using structure str scene 3. The levels are A, B, C, and D. When we use this model matrix function, it creates three rows for x2 variable, x1b, x2c, and x2d. The A is base category, and that's why it is excluded. It is skipped from the model matrix. Similarly, this model matrix will also create the interaction term, x1 colon x2b, x1 colon x2c, and x2 colon x2d. These are the interaction effect. And the right-hand column, from this column, there are interaction effect. And these columns are the main effects. If we had used only this, only colon instead of this asterisk, then these three columns would be excluded in this formula. And that's why asterisk is better and more appropriate symbol for this interaction. The next exercise asks, using the basic principles, convert this formula in the following two model into function. And it gives hint that start by converting the categorical variable into 0, 1 variables. So these are the formulas. So in fact, I am also not clear what it wants us to do. What kind of function should we construct? Do we need to create a model matrix, or do we need to solve the equation using these functions? So I have skipped this for now, at least. The next exercise asks for scene 4, which of the mod 1 or mod 2 is better? The writer thinks that mod 2 does a slightly better job at removing pattern, but it's pretty subtle. Can you come up with a plot? Yes, we can plot it. Mod 1 is this. Mod 1 doesn't have interaction effect, and mod 2 has interaction. So to construct residual versus fitted plot, we will have to use augment function from broom package. So mod 1 and mod 2, residual versus fitted data. So these are the two data sets that we will need. Then in the ggplot, we are using this. This is for mod 1 and this for mod 2. There is not much different as such. But we can see that mod 1 has more outlier values. There are more points in, like here on the left top side and right top side, there are more, and left bottom also. But in this case, there are fewer. Compared to this, the third from top left, then there is one, and there is one in the bottom side at minus 6. But still, we are checking the standard deviation of the residual. See, it is less in mod 2. And that's why we are saying that Model 2 performs slightly better, just slightly better, because the standard deviation just slightly less, not much difference as such. Should we go ahead with model building exercises also, or should we call it a day for today?
Anything is fine, Malik. If not, no, we need not do it next week also. You can just share it with us. We'll all go through it. Is that okay?
Okay.
On Slack?
I don't mind that too.
Yeah, because I've actually not done the exercises for model building and the next chapter. So if you could share, then I'll go through it as well. Okay, then we'll ask if we can present the next chapter.
Okay, then. So then in that case, we will move to this R Markdown chapters, right?
Yes.
And who will present it?
I'll ask around if Arnab or Meenakshi can present. If not, then I'll present.
Okay, then. In that case, yep. I'll be sharing this R Markdown document itself.
Yes, thank you so much. I think it's pretty complete, right? You have all the exercises and the solution. So
yes. All the exercises, I have included it, even the many models chapter also.
Perfect. Okay.
Okay, then.
Thank you so much, Malik. I'm sorry, last week I couldn't attend because of something, but I didn't know that it didn't happen. Yeah.
In fact, I was also getting some problems. I don't have router. I was using hotspot and I was getting too many calls on that day.
Okay.
So by the time I could join, no one was there.
Okay. Molly, but do you use machine learning models? No, right? You had told me that.
I am trying it. I am actually learning it. But in my college, we are using only econometrics. So we don't use resampling methods at all.
Okay.
I would say yes. So I am also learning. I want to use the tidy model workflow. But when I want to use the tidy model workflow on the data set from my book, then I am not getting the results. I mean, the results are very much different from the book's results. So I am not sure what the problem is.
Correct. Yeah. But other than that, which models are you looking at? Like, what are you learning? Which models, machine learning models are you looking? Do you have a classification problem or a regression problem?
I'm generally using regression problem only.
Okay.
Because in my econometrics class, we are using linear models most of the time. Linear model or at the max general linear, GLM.
Okay. Yeah. Because I have also started using machine learning, and I also get stuck because I don't have so many predictor variables, and I'm also doing a regression problem. So I just wanted to know if you have any resources to understand these kind of modeling, different machine learning models for regression problems, using R, of course.
I think you should enroll in this tidy models with our book club.
Tidy Models is a book?
Yes, TMWR, Tidy Models with R. There is a book.
Thank you. Yes. Okay. I'll do that.
Basically, actually, there was another book called Applied Predictive Modeling. It was also written by the same Max Kuhn. It was a book accompanying the Correct package. And this Correct package gave a unified interface to many machine learning models, many that would include classification and regression both. For example, linear regression, generalized linear regression, k nearest neighbor, principal component, everything was included there. But it was using Bayes-R techniques. There is another book now, TMWR, which incorporates the tidy model in place of Correct. So now tidy model is probably replacing the Correct package itself.
Oh, yes. I think you have shared us that link. Yeah,
yes.
You
have. So TMWR, we have a channel in our Slack workplace itself, TMWR. And there are at least 3 codes for TMWR book also.
Okay, cool. Thank you so much. Maulik, please share this with us. I will also go through it.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.